In the news today from the Strange and Weird Fact File.
What in the foxicle is this?
Today, the Daily Mail published an article online about a book that Michael scribbled in that has gone on sale at auction. The name of the book is The 48 Laws of Power by Robert Greene. The 48 Laws of Power is a practical, readable guide for anyone who wants power, watches power, or want to arm themselves against power. The 48 Laws of Power is the essential and controversial guide to modern manipulation. In a bold and elegant two-color package, The 48 Laws of Power synthesizes the philosophies of Machiavelli, Sun Tzu, and Karl von Clausewitz, with the historical legacies of statesmen, warriors, seducers, and con men throughout the ages. The book teaches you how to gain power, or how to outsmart those with power. The article shows a few pictures of pages that Michael wrote notes in. I will cover those pages in this video. Law number 34. Be royal in your own fashion. Act like a king. Marked as true by Michael is the following quote. The way you carry yourself will often determine how you are treated. In the long run, appearing vulgar or common will make people disrespect you. For a king respects himself and inspires the same sentiment in others. By acting regally and confident of your powers, you make yourself seem destined to wear a crown. The part that he underlines says, once the king had made news by treating the banker as an equal, now the banker treated the king as an inferior. The story behind that is as follows. Louis-Philippe I was king of the French from 1830 to 1848. Like his father, Louis-Philippe II, Duke of Orleans, he initially supported the French Revolution. However, following the deposition and execution of his cousin, King Louis XVI, Louis-Philippe fled the country. His father, despite having denounced his son's actions, and voted for the death of the king, was imprisoned and executed that same year. Louis-Philippe spent the next 21 years in exile before returning during the Bourbon Restoration. In July of 1830, a revolution broke out in Paris that forced the king, Charles X, to abdicate. A commission of the highest authorities in the land gathered to choose a successor, and the man they picked was Louis-Philippe, the Duke of Orleans. The reign of Louis-Philippe, known as the July Monarchy, was dominated by wealthy industrialists and bankers. When Louis-Philippe invited James Rothschild, the most important banker in France, to his palace, he treated him as an equal. The bankers, to whom Louis-Philippe was the most beholden, soon realized that it was they who controlled the country, not he, and they treated him with growing contempt. One day, at the start of a train trip organized for the royal family, James Rothschild actually berated him, and in public, for being late. Once the king had made news by treating the banker as an equal, now the banker treated the king as an inferior. His popularity faded as economic conditions in France deteriorated in 1847, and he was forced to abdicate after the outbreak of the French Revolution of 1848. He lived out his life in exile in the United Kingdom. His supporters were known as Orleanists, as opposed to Legitimists who supported the main line of the House of Bourbon. Michael wrote in the side notes, "You create your own circumstances even in the manner in which you are treated and looked upon." There is a part of the story about Louis-Philippe that Michael marked and put "wow" under. In early 1848, Frenchmen of all classes began to demonstrate for electoral reforms that would make the country truly democratic. By February, the demonstrations had turned violent. To assuage the populace, Louis Philippe fired his prime minister and appointed a liberal as a replacement. But this created the opposites of the desired effect, the people sensed they could push the king around. The demonstrations turned into a full-fledged revolution, with gunfire and barricades in the streets. What the law says is that if you ask for less, you receive less. What you tolerate is what you end up with. In other words, don't be a wet noodle. If you want a million, ask for 2 million. Balthazar Grayson said, "Everyone should be royal after his own fashion. Let all your actions, even though they are not those of a king, be, in their own sphere, worthy of one. Be sublime in your deeds, lofty in your thoughts, and in all your doings show that you deserve to be a king even though you are not one in reality." Law number 24. Play the perfect courtier. One cannot spell courtiership without Charles Maurice de Talleyrand Perigord, the man who brought down Napoleon Bonaparte. Master of the battlefield, with extreme subtlety, you are a courtier, whether you like it or not. You must play the game of power, so you might as well choose to be good at it. The perfect courtier obeys his masters, but shines in his own light. He is not powerless, doesn't trust, but appears trustful, doesn't talk much, but finds the right words and the right timing when he does. Everyone likes him. He is charming, witty and helpful. He appears to be neutral, a paragon of honesty and fairness. He always has a genuine smile on his face and we don't doubt his intentions for one second. Although he is a great talent, we are not threatened by him. We seek him as an ally. This way, the perfect courtier holds more power than the king himself, without the dangers of that position. As we target the highest authorities, he's in the shadows, observing the current state of the chessboard. Pieces may fall and be sacrificed on both ends, but he is winning regardless. Michael highlighted the parts that say that in order to gain and maintain power, you need to act. Act as if everything you do comes with ease. Make yourself stand out from the rest, alter your style and language according to the person you are dealing with, and lie and manipulate where necessary. Law number 16. Use absence to increase respect and honor. Too much circulation makes the price go down. The more you are seen and heard from, the more common you appear. If you are already established in a group, temporary withdrawal from it will make you more talked about, even more admired. You must learn when to leave. Create value through scarcity. Michael adds to that by mentioning that deer are more special than dogs because they hide. And because the moon comes every night, people don't bother looking for it anymore. There is an interesting advice in the book. Once you die, everything about you will seem different. You will be surrounded by an instant aura of respect. People will remember their criticisms of you, their arguments with you, and will be filled with regret and guilt. They are missing a presence that will never return. But you do not have to wait until you die. By completely withdrawing for a while, you create a kind of death before death. And when you come back, it will be as if you had come back from the dead, an air of resurrection will cling to you, and people will be relieved at your return. Law number 8. Make other people come to you. Use bait if necessary. When I have laid bait for deer, I don't shoot at the first doe that comes to sniff, but wait until the whole herd has gathered round. Otto von Bismarck. Force your opponents to react to your moves. When you force the other person to act, you are the one in control. You become the puppet master. It is always better to make your opponent come to you, abandoning his own plans in the process. Lure him with fabulous gains, then attack. You hold the cards. The chapter explains the military master plan of Talleyrand to bait Napoleon into escaping from Elba, so he could crush him for once and for all. Michael seems to focus on Napoleon's exile to Elba and how his life was a mockery of his previous glory to humiliate him. I put the laws in this order, because this is the order they were in on the Daily Mail website. Let's recap which laws were highlighted. Be royal in your own fashion, act like a king to be treated like one. Play the perfect courtier. Use absence to increase respect and honor. Make other people come to you, use bait if necessary. In light of my latest video, Michael Jackson, Humbug of the World, I thought this article and this book being sold was very interesting. The four highlighted laws are a summary of that video: be bold, be a king. Make a humbug of yourself to gain power. Be likable and stay neutral to be able to maintain that power. Then disappear and sit back and watch the chessboard, waiting for those who did you wrong to take the bait and get crushed. Also, there is a full chapter about P.T. Barnum in the book. Law 6 says, court attention at all cost. Burning more brightly than those around you is a skill that no one is born with. You have to learn to attract attention, as surely as the lodestone attracts iron. At the start of your career, you must attach your name and reputation to a quality, an image, that sets you apart from other people. This image can be something like a characteristic style of dress, or a personality quirk that amuses people and gets talked about. Once the image is established, you have an appearance, a place in the sky for your star. It is a common mistake to imagine that this peculiar appearance of yours should not be controversial, that to be attacked is somehow bad. Nothing could be further from the truth. To avoid being a flash in the pan, and having your notoriety eclipsed by another, you must not discriminate between different types of attention. In the end, every kind will work in your favor. Barnum welcomed personal attacks and felt no need to defend himself. He deliberately courted the image of being a humbug. The Michael Jackson death hoax is a series of events which are leading to an examination of what was ever true in our world. And Michael's.
I ain't letting Cable kill this kid. But I can't do this alone.
Can you speak up? It's hard to hear you with that pity dick in your mouth.
We're gonna form a super duper fucking group. We need them tough, morally flexible, and young enough to carry their own franchise for 10 to 12 years.
We will be known as X-Force.
Isn't that a little derivative?
You're absolutely right. Now, let's go get our fuck on.
Don't call it a comeback! I've been here for years, I'm rocking my fears. What the fuck is the fear? Making the tears,